Good morning. Welcome to Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We are a community of diverse beliefs and experiences, nurturing the liberal religious spirit and united by our desire to grow in love and in service. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever your life's journey, you are welcome here. Whether you gather with us every Sunday, once or twice a year, or are with us this morning for the first time, we are glad you are here. I'm Reverend Sharon Wiley, Chalice's minister. Our worship musician this morning is Justin Gray, and we have several different song leaders, and thank you to each one. Welcome to this online worship service. For those of you who like to use the chat during the service, and we're greeting each other there now, please be sure that when you post that you use that little blue menu to drop down and select panelists and attendees. If you only post to panelists, it only comes to me and I might not see it during the service. And we like to use chat to talk to each other, not just to me. So this is me standing at the door on Sunday morning saying, welcome, how good to see you. Let's give ourselves a hug. If you share space with someone, maybe give them a hug too. Good morning. I want to especially welcome those of you who are newcomers at Chalice. In addition to this online worship, we have many groups and activities that are happening online as well. Our activities like our women's book club, men's breakfast group, support groups, religious education for children, all these and more are happening online. You don't have to be a member to participate in our groups and activities. They are open to everyone. So if you are new to Chalice and would like to learn more about our activities, and particularly if you'd like to get onto our email list, please stay in this Zoom after the service ends and we'll use the chat for our newcomer chat. Now, let's take a breath together. We begin our service by acknowledging that wherever each of us is watching, if we are in what is now called the United States, then we are on land stolen from Indigenous peoples. Our congregational home in what is now called Escondido is on land that is part of the traditional territories of the 12 bands of the Kumeyaay Nation and the seven bands of the Payamkechum, also called the Luiseno. Land that is sacred to us now was stolen from people for whom that land is also and still sacred. As we continue our work as a community of shared faith, may we strive to build relationships with Kumeyaay and Payamkechum peoples, and may we find our way to right relationship with our local tribes. Now we light our chalice, the symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith. The flaming chalice was first used during World War II by the Unitarian Service Committee as a symbol of life-saving refuge for people fleeing persecution in Europe. May our chalice flame burn brightly, that all who are seeking may find us. Thank you. This was a difficult week again. This is a difficult time still. The world full of chaos and conflict still. People are dying. Storms threaten. Turmoil abounds. Again, still, like always. We gather together each week, sheltered against the storm, sheltered together against storms that have been raging for decades, for millennia. Each wounded soul is welcome here, each broken spirit, each weary heart. Together we take shelter and sing and cry, mourn and rejoice, hopeful that our shared healing here will in turn help heal a hurting world. Let us worship together. You are invited to join in singing. Our Sunday worship is the shared spiritual practice of our community, and we tend to the congregation during this time by honoring our joys and sorrows. If you would like to share a joy or sorrow with the congregation this morning, now is the time for sharing in the chat box. These won't be spoken out loud, so you don't need to worry about them being captured in our recording. If you would like to send me a confidential note about your joy or sorrow, please email me. I'll put my email in the chat box. Thank you.
Such is me.
Such is me.
Such is me.
Such is me.
Such is love.
Such is love.
All this joy.
All this joy.
All this sorrow.
All this sorrow.
All this hope.
All this hope.
All this
pain. All this
pain. Such is love.
Such is me.
Such is me.
Such is me.
Such is me.
Such is
love.
Such is love.
All this joy.
All this joy.
All this sorrow.
All this sorrow.
All this
hope. All this hope.
All this
pain. All this
pain. Such is love.
Our story today is called Be Kind by Pat Zietlow Miller and illustrated by Jen Hill. Tanisha spilled grape juice yesterday, all over her new dress. Everyone laughed. I almost did, too. But Mom always tells me to be kind, so I tried. I don't think it worked. I said, "Purple is my favorite color." I thought Tanisha would smile, but she ran into the hall instead. When she came back, snack time was over. She put on her art smock and didn't look at anyone. I almost told Tanisha that art was my favorite class, but I didn't want her to leave again. So I painted purple splotches and added some green until I had a bunch of beautiful violets. While I painted, I thought about Tanisha. Should I have handed her my napkin? Let her borrow my sweatshirt? Spilled my juice so everyone stared at me instead? What does it mean to be kind, anyway? Maybe it's giving. Making cookies for Mr. Rinaldi, who lives alone. Letting someone with smaller feet have my too tight shoes. He might win races in them, too. Maybe it's helping, putting dirty dishes in the sink. Cleaning up after Otis, our class guinea pig. He's a messy eater. Maybe it's paying attention, telling Desmond I like his blue boots, asking the new girl to be my partner. Listening to Aunt Franny's stories, even the ones I've heard before. Being kind should be easy, like throwing away a wrapper or recycling a bottle, or saying thank you and bless you. My mom says the quickest way to be kind is to use people's names. Hey, Carla. What's new, Omar? Good afternoon, Rabbi Mandelbaum. Being kind can be hard, too, even when you know what to do. Teaching someone something I'm good at is tricky, even when I'm patient. And sticking up for someone when other kids aren't kind is really hard and really scary. Maybe I can't solve Tanisha's grape juice problem. Maybe all I can do is sit by her in art class and paint this picture for her, because I know she likes purple too. Maybe I can only do small things, but my small things might join small things other people do. And together, they could grow into something big, something really big, so big that all our kindnesses spill out of our school. spread throughout town, travel across the country, and go all the way around the world. Right back to Tanisha and me, so we can be kind again. And again, and again. Besides trauma, there is something else human beings routinely pass on from person to person and from generation to generation. Resilience. Resilience is built into the very cells of our bodies. It is as much a part of us as our ability to heal. Like trauma, resilience can ripple outward, changing the lives of people, families, neighborhoods, and communities in positive ways. However, resilience is often misunderstood. It is typically viewed as the ability to bounce back from adversity, often in a heroic, individualized act. Furthermore, that ability is often seen as something learned or acquired in childhood, the result of supportive parenting, the presence of other caring adults, and so on. But the full picture of resilience is much broader and much more organic. First, resilience is both intrinsic and learned, a combination of nature, what you're born with, and nurture, the circumstances you encounter, especially as you grow up. Second, resilience manifests both individually and collectively. Sometimes it does take the form of a personal individual act. Often, however, resilience is expressed communally by a group, a family, an organization, or a culture. Suppose you're running a marathon. Halfway through, exhausted, you trip and fall. Your legs ache and you're bleeding from both knees. You pull yourself to your feet and decide it's time to quit the race. Then five of your friends and family members show up beside you. "You can do it," they shout. "You finished last year. You can finish this time. Go for it." Next thing you know, you're off and running again. Clearly, this required resilience, but the resilience wasn't just inside of you. It also came from the words and actions of people who care for you and from your relationship with them. Anne Mastin, one of the leading researchers on resilience in children, expresses it this way. "I like to say that the resilience of a child is distributed. It's not just in the child. It's distributed in their relationships with the many other people who make up their world." Third, resilience isn't just about responding to or getting through a difficult experience. Resilience also manifests in a form that's more about being than doing. This aspect of resilience helps us stay grounded and settled no matter what happens to us. It enables us to sustain and protect ourselves and each other over time. It's a way for our bodies to access possibility and coherence, regardless of the circumstances. It's not so much a response as it is a way of showing up, a way of tapping into the energies that surround and move through everything in our world. Resilience can be built and strengthened, both individually and collectively. We African Americans took pains to build resilience in ourselves and our children for many generations. If we didn't, we wouldn't have survived. For 400 years, with many successes and many failures, we have sought to counter new and old trauma with both the resilience we were born with and the resilience we grew and taught each other to grow. I often tell people that resilience is not a thing or an attribute, but a flow. It moves through the body and between multiple bodies when they are harmonized. It is neither built nor developed. It is taken in and expressed as part of a larger relationship with a family, a group, a community, or the world at large. Notice how this takes place, not just in the cognitive mind, but in the body, and in the minds and bodies of others, and in the collective body of people who care about us. Resilience, something some of us might be thinking about these days. Each church year, I pick a topic for a 10-part sermon series for us to study deeply together. And we call this our spirit study topic for the year. This year, we're working with the book I just read from, My Grandmother's Hands, Racialized Trauma and the Pathway to Mending Our Hearts and Bodies, written by trauma specialist Resmaa Menakem. And today is my second sermon in this series. So we're going to be talking a lot about trauma this year, and racialized trauma in particular. One of Menakem's central points is that in the United States, we all have racialized trauma to process, especially white people and Black people, through our everyday existence as people in the United States, and through the physical impacts of trauma that get passed down through generations. I expect that the idea that trauma can pass from generation to generation might be new to many of us. This is a very new area of study in the past 10 years or so. So if you're interested in learning more about the science behind that, you can do a search for inherited trauma. But as a quick example, a 2018 article by Olga Kazan in The Atlantic magazine described a study wherein mice that have been taught to fear the smell of cherries when it was paired with an electric shock. So mice who learned to fear that smell had children and grandchildren that also showed signs of anxiety when exposed to that odor, even though they had never gone through that learning of having the shock come with the odor, that painful association. So we don't fully know mechanically in the body what is happening, but we're trying to learn more about that. So that's just a quick, you know, example with mice, but there are studies being done with humans, with descendants of people who have lived through wars, looking at the physical impacts of racism, and so on. So for people who are studying trauma and working with the after effects of trauma, this is one of the vibrant and evolving areas of learning. And like all new areas of discovery, there's much debate and there's much that's still unknown. And I suspect that although that might be news to many of us, that trauma can be inherited, passed down, I also think at a different level, a less scientific level, maybe, we're not surprised at all. Because don't we have a deep yearning, many of us, to know the stories of our ancestors, to know our connections to previous generations? Millions of people are sending their DNA in for testing to places like ancestry.com to find out more about their history and their family tree. Those of us who have done genealogy research know the deep delight. It's hard to put into words, really, that feeling when you come across a new piece of information that reveals a fuller story about the past. It's more than just the pleasure of research for many of us. It is something about knowing and understanding our own physical selves better. As we talk about trauma, I want you to keep in mind that trauma is the response to an event, not the event itself. The pandemic isn't a trauma, but it is traumatizing. We are having trauma responses to live through this. How each of us is impacted will be different. Two people who experience the same event can have very different reactions. One person may be traumatized and another person not at all. So when we're talking about trauma, we're very much talking about the interactions of a set of particular people and circumstances, not a one-size-fits-all solution. There is no telling how we are being changed by what we're living through now. Menakem describes two kinds of pain. We talked about this last time, clean pain and dirty pain. Clean pain is the pain we let ourselves feel it, and we learn from it, we process it. The word he uses is metabolize, which I love, as it suggests processing it for energy to go forward. We metabolize the pain and we grow as a result. It's a fairly common process demonstrating emotional maturity. All of us will have examples of clean pain in our lives. Dirty pain, however, is the pain of avoidance, blame, and denial. As Menakem describes, a key factor in the perpetuation of white body supremacy is many people's refusal to experience clean pain around the myth of race. Instead, usually out of fear, they choose the dirty pain of silence and avoidance, and invariably prolong the pain. He writes, refusing to heal is always more painful. I think many of us know that and have experienced it in our own lives. There was a photo going around Twitter this week of Joe Biden and his son, Hunter Biden. Here it is. One person tweeted it out asking, does this look like an appropriate father-son interaction to you? The overwhelming response of the internet, I'm so glad to say, was that yes, it is appropriate for fathers and sons to be affectionate to each other. And this even led to an opinion piece by Tom Nichols in USA Today with the headline, Real Men Embrace Their Sons and Fathers, Just Like Joe and Hunter Biden in That Photo. You can imagine some of the negative responses to the photo, people for whom the idea of masculinity requires distance and stoicism, even anger, that traditional and rigid form of masculinity, what we would now call toxic masculinity, that denounces anything loving and expressive as soft and feminine, and therefore incompatible with being a man. These are the traditional teachings of our patriarchal culture, and it is the work of all of us, but men in particular, to either overcome the trauma of those teachings, to feel that pain, learn from it, and turn it into clean pain, or to remain in the dirty pain of that trauma, a traumatic response to those teachings. Men can learn from the pain of toxic masculinity, metabolize that pain, make it what Menakem calls a clean pain, or men can remain embedded in the pain of toxic masculinity, choosing silence and avoidance, even defending those traditional ideas in order to avoid doing the work of healing. What Menakem calls dirty pain, unprocessed, unhealed, unresolved. Those are the voices deriding a photo of a father embracing his son. It is disheartening to realize that we may be living in a world with far more dirty pain than clean. James Baldwin wrote, ahead of his time as always, I imagine one of the reasons people cling to their hate so stubbornly is because they sense once hate is gone, they will be forced to deal with pain. The world seems full at times with people clinging to their hates. May more and more of us have the courage to let go our hates and confront our pain. Please join in singing.
Mm-hmm.
The Sunday offering is an expression of the generosity that makes our congregational life possible. As Buddhist teacher Joseph Goldstein has said, it is important to understand that generosity is a practice. It's not just a single event. It's a quality in our hearts and minds that we can develop and cultivate. Please text your donation to Chalice. If you haven't texted a donation before, know that once you text the amount, the number, you'll get a reply with a link to follow to enter your credit card information. Once you've done this once, you don't need to enter the information again. If your Sunday donation is part of your pledge payment, please be sure to indicate pledge after the dollar amount. And you can make a text donation anytime. It doesn't need to be during this service. The phone number will be on screen in a moment and I'll put it in the chat box. Please give generously. Please join in dedicating our offering with words of affirmation. May love be the spirit of this church. May the quest for truth be its sacrament and service be its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, and to help one another in fellowship. This is our aspiration.
Lamentation.
Well, we continue to live through exceedingly stressful times. I've mentioned before that we should expect it to take a while for votes to be counted. In California, as long as mail-in ballots are postmarked by Election Day, they can be received until November 20th, and then they'll still need to be counted. So there will be results in California we won't know until the end of the month. And that's just the scenario in our particular state. Each state has its own guidelines, its own deadlines. So unless you're unusually calm, cool, and collected, we can expect to continue living with stress and anxiety for weeks to come, not to mention continuing to cope with the stresses of the pandemic. Resmaa Menakem's book invites us to be aware of and to listen to our bodies. The body is the place where unhealed trauma lives. The body is also the place where fear and anxiety manifest in our racing hearts, our clenched teeth, our bodies that may not be sleeping well or maybe sleeping a lot, appetites that are impacted. I want to encourage you, if you're not good at this, to start listening to your body. And I want you to be aware that we receive many, many messages in our culture that our bodies are not to be trusted. Many of us were raised in faith traditions that taught us that the body is sinful. We're still fighting culture wars over what is and isn't allowable with our bodies. The controversy I spoke of earlier is basically about how men use their bodies. Is it okay for men to hug? So if you've been taught that it's not, then what is it like when you need a hug? I also spoke a few weeks ago about diet culture, and I invite you to notice all the ways that diet culture tells us that our bodies must be tightly controlled, that if we really ate whatever we want, that it would be terrible and out of control. We get lots of messages that feeling hungry is not okay, or wanting sweets is not okay, that the appropriate response to hunger or to a craving is to do anything but eat, to respond to that hunger or that craving, to drink water or take a nap or call a friend. I want to encourage you to eat when you're hungry and to eat what sounds good to you. Listening to our bodies will be a new skill for many of us. When you start to pay attention to your body, you will find many opportunities for soothing yourself, for coping with the fear and anxiety we're all living in. So have you noticed how dogs shake when they're scared? They kind of tremble, like when there's a storm or something. Letting yourself shake like that can sometimes be helpful. It helps the body release stress. Again, as humans, we feel like the body is supposed to act a certain way. If you're freaking out, you know, give yourself some time, lean into it, tremble away, see how it feels. Rocking yourself is another self-soothing technique. Great if you have a rocking chair, but you can also sit in a static chair and rock forward and back or side to side. These days when our hymns come up, I'm in my office singing loudly and I'm swaying quite a lot. That feels really good right now. These repetitive movements can be calming. Self-hugs can be calming. So I invite you to realize that many of the things we can do to help manage anxiety and stress are physical. They involve our physical bodies, drinking tea, taking a bath, going for a walk, stretching. When you notice yourself feeling upset, anxious, fearful, that's a time, a recognition moment to tune in to the body. What would feel good to the body? What would help you? What would help us become more grounded and centered? Our thoughts are often what is making us feel fearful and nervous. And then when we can tune into the body, that helps us get out of our head, which can help us feel calmer. So we are entering our eighth month of the pandemic. We are doing amazing. You are doing amazing. This is so hard, what we're doing, but we are protecting ourselves and each other and doing what we need to do to help each other get through this. Part of why I wanted to share that reading from Resmaa Menakem about resilience, even though it wasn't directly connected to the rest of what I was talking about today, is to recognize that resilience happens in groups, in communities of people, that we help each other get through. And I think at Chalice, we are here for each other. If you're struggling, reach out, email me, email another friend. We're here to pick each other up and cheer each other on to keep going. We couldn't have guessed when this started, anything about where we are today. And of course, we don't know what's going to happen in months to come. But we're doing great. I want to tell you, I know we are a community that takes the pandemic very seriously, and I'm grateful for that. But I also know that the more time that goes on and you don't get sick, I don't get sick, we become less careful than we used to be. I know I am. We're much less careful about the things we bring into the house and washing them and all those things. And part of that is because we know more than we used to about how COVID most commonly spreads, the coronavirus. But a friend of mine just recently tested positive, and he has risk factors. So he was being very careful. And so he frankly doesn't know how he caught it. It was such a reminder to me that we don't know everything, and that we have to continue being so careful. So that's what I'm telling you this morning. Be careful. Be careful, like our lives depend on it. Blessed be, beloveds. Please join in singing.
Please join me in singing hymn number 131, Love Will Guide Us.
Love will guide us, peace has tried us, hope inside us will lead the way. On the road from greed to giving, you can change the world with your love. If you cannot sing like angels, if you cannot speak before thousands, you can give from deep within you. You can change the world with your love. You are like no other being. What you can give, no other can give to the future of our precious children, to the future of the world where we live. Love will guide us, peace has tried us, hope inside us will lead the on the road from greed to giving. You can change the world with your love.
Our closing words come from Reverend Joanna Fontaine Crawford. May you go forward knowing that life is fragile and a gift, that you are lovable and loved, and you are not alone. Love and blessings to each of you. Blessed be. You're invited to close our time together by singing the well. Newcomers are invited to stay here in the worship for newcomer chat, and everyone is invited to our coffee hour.